I'm Michael Alexander, the Director of City Conversations. We're presented by SFU Public Square, and we want to thank our sponsors, SFU Vancouver and the SFU City Program. We want to acknowledge that we are on unceded lands, the lands of the Coast Salish people. We took a larger room today because we knew there'd be a big crowd for this event, but it's still very, very formal. But despite that, we do not have speakers at City Conversations, and we do not have an audience. Instead, we have presenters, and our four presenters will be up at the front, and you are participants. Presenters will briefly frame the conversation by probably 5 minutes apiece, but most of the time is for your questions, your opinions, your observations, both to the presenters and back and forth within the amongst the participants. The point is to encourage conversation. If you brought your lunch, thank you very much. It is not rude to eat your lunch at City Conversation. Just please unwrap your sandwiches now. I had one person say that they did that they should be on an email list, and they haven't been getting emails. If you are not on our email list, or you have not been getting emails to this conversation, please put your name and email on the contact sheets, which will be circulating during the conversation. If you are tweeting, it's @CityCon. Today our conversation is about the future of our downtown waterfront. Glassy Monuments Tower looming over historic waterfront station. An approved 30-story tower across the street replacing this parkade. Towers perhaps replacing portions of the historic Sinclair Center. The city's best use from its celebration street, Granville Street, hidden for decades by the black mob of parkade entrance. Inhospitable landscapes. And streetscapes, the only street-level views, this is across the street from that streetscape, the only street-level views of water and mountains possibly lost, new developments being designed over the train yard, tens of thousands of people passing daily through the province's transportation center without a reason to linger, a city transportation and development plan years in the making, very well done, but lacking an implementation strategy and perhaps needing some tweaks. Vancouver's downtown waterfront is suddenly in play, and all of these projects and opportunities seem to be on independent tracks. Do landowners and developers make independent decisions, or does the city act as a coordinator, facilitator, and advocate for the public? Our presenters today are Graham McGarva, principal of IA Architect, and could you come up as I introduce you, which is working on designs for a tower at Granville and Cordova Street to replace that seven-story parkade, and developments over the CPR rail yards. Anita Malaro is the assistant director of planning, and Steve Brown is the manager of traffic and data management at the City of Vancouver. And Frank Ducote is representing the Citizens Downtown Waterfront Working Group. We invited representatives of Cadillac Fairview, which owns Granville Square, Waterfront Station, and the adjacent parking lot planned for development. And also, we invited Port Metro Vancouver. Cadillac Fairview called early and sent its regrets that he could not get the vice president here from Toronto for this event. We heard this morning from Port Metro Vancouver saying they're busy. Is anyone here on behalf of Port Metro Vancouver or Cadillac Fairview? Would you raise your hand? No? Okay. Thank you. Please join us. So, we're going to start, and who is going to start? And you, Dale?
And Steve.
And Steve? Okay. Give me a moment to set one.
So, thank you, everybody, for coming. Steve and I are, the waterfront health plan was, Fremont plan was approved by council back in 2009. Steve and I were both intimately involved with its creation and development. So we're happy to be here to present the waterfront health plan and to give you an overview of the goals and objectives set out within it. So the vision for the waterfront health plan, So the vision is for a world-class transportation interchange and dynamic new downtown extension in the central waterfront area. The hub study area included the lands, the waterfront station, Granville 200, and over the rail tracks, and included the C-bus area.
Actually, maybe just before we move off this, I just want to make a comment about from a transportation perspective and looking at a transportation hub. This area basically has all modes of transportation in it, and I challenge you to find a place in the world that has all the transportation modes that are in this location. Because we have air, we have rail, there's freight movement, and that's the big one that I haven't been able, when we were doing the study, I couldn't find a location that had an active freight rail yard underneath the hub development there. And then seaplanes, helicopter, cruise ship terminals, basically everything in there that you could think of.
Land ownership of this area is quite complex. You can see by the diagram here that the track lands that we were looking at were actually owned by Vancouver Whitecaps. Long before the previous to the hub plan, it was the Vancouver Whitecaps were looking to locate a soccer stadium there. I don't know if any of you remember that. But they still own the lands, and the rails have the right to operate within those. The waterfront station and Granville 200 are both owned by Cadillac Fairview, managed by Cadillac Fairview. And of course, the federal governments own Sinclair Center, and Vancouver Whitecaps are the owners representing the recently approved tower at 320 Granville. So the city doesn't actually own any land in this particular area. Oh, I should also mention that the port, of course, owns land in this area as well. So the city actually doesn't own any land in this area. However, we do have some rights of access, in particularly over the east end of the waterfront station site. We have a right of access to create a road through that parking lot that exists today. That road has been called the Cordova Connector. So the urban design transportation objectives for the plan have three main pieces. Connect the city with the waterfront, introduce a high quality new development integrated with the transit hub, and create a world-class transportation interchange. So the first one, connect the city with the waterfront. How do we do that? First thing that we looked at was extend Granville Place Road. And because we also have a goal in conjunction with the port, who were also partners in this exercise, to link Canada Place Road down to Waterfront Road in order to link the portlands also with the city. And as I mentioned just previously, we also have a goal to create the Cordova Connector. Now, you have to appreciate these diagrams that we're showing here are showing roads that are elevated at the grade heights over the railway tracks. Another objective was to try and achieve a long-standing urban design principle that the city has about creating street end views to, in order for pedestrians to be able to see the water or the mountains beyond. We certainly can achieve that with a Cordova connector. One of the big challenges we have is how do we do that with Bramble Street? So that was an idea that we thought was important in pursuing and understanding how we could achieve that. So the plan actually looks at how can we get the what we call the Bramble Street extension, and at what elevation it would connect with Canada Place extension. And then another road in there is a hub street. And Steve is going to talk a little bit more about the transportation needs of the area and why these series of roads and how they're configured are critical for serving the area, not only the development of the area, but also the transportation hub. Other objectives with connecting the city to the waterfront is to extend our waterfront walkway that goes around the edge of the city. So that was a key goal. And also to look at open space opportunities, particularly at those street end views, and to provide people places to look out over the water and to the mountains beyond. Beyond, you know, instead of being held back where we are today with the current little parking lot plaza, we're held back from the water because of the rail tracks. Also to look at open space linkages within the plan to help facilitate transportation movements between the different modes. The next piece of urban design objective was to introduce a high quality new development integrated with the transportation hub. And that's really to create a high density commercial and mixed use development that takes advantage of excellent transit accessibility to support increased transit riders, extend the central business district as well as complements the activities of Gastown. The architecture of the area would be of exceptional quality, reflecting the prominence of the setting and respecting the existing heritage buildings, and a commitment to environmental sustainability in all aspects of the design and construction of the buildings.
Okay, so from a transportation perspective, there was a number of goals within this area. As we mentioned, the passenger concourse, what's there right now doesn't really respect the movement that's required in that area. So having a more grand passenger concourse where you can have all those movements happen and not feel constrained. A marine transit terminal. So right now there's the sea bus down there. In the past, we've had various forms of passenger ferries coming in and out of that area. So in the future, we could see that happening again and connecting to a lot of the islands and that's something that's destined to come at pretty much at any moment. There's been a number of tries in the past, and at some point it's going to be successful. Clear and direct and attractive links. If you have a transit hub and you have all these interconnections, you need to have the ability for big movements to happen in those areas so that you know where to wayfind and how to get to these cities. And that's what any major transportation hub in the world would have, that kind of facility. And then the other thing is looking long term. Like, don't just think about what's there now, but what's going to be coming in the future. Increased passenger rail. Right now we've got West Coast Express that comes into that area, and the other passenger rail kind of ends at the flats. But in the future, we could see that coming right into the downtown, connecting into this hub. So what does that look like? Here's some good examples of what a world-class hub would look like from other areas in the world, right? Like in Berlin and London, they have these facilities that have these connections in between, and it doesn't feel cramped. More examples of this, wide open spaces, ability to make those connections. And so what do we have? It starts pretty well at the street with the Heritage Building, but then when you go in there, it's all cramped space. If everyone's ever been there when a West Coast Express train comes in, good luck in trying to connect between any of those areas. Or same with the sea bus and coming across those narrow walkways. This shouldn't be something that would happen at a world-class transportation hub. Michael mentioned earlier about like tens of thousands of people going through this area. Actually, it's hundreds of thousands it's close to about 100,000 that enter into the hub, and then they connect to all the different modes. Today, these projections were done when we did the hub planning, and so the 2011 were projections. And today, when we look at boardings in those areas, it's well over 100,000 that are connecting between these areas. So, looking at the components, you can see, you know, we need to have a good connection between the marine terminal and the land terminal, and the ability to both have all the connections at the land terminal, but also connect to them in a way that can act as a fair paid zone, so you don't have to go out and go through fare gates and that as you connect to all these different areas. There's also the existing heliport there, which is something that we explored, how that can continue to happen in the area. I'm just going to skip through some of these and go to the street network. So before I hand over, maybe I'll just talk a bit about, Anita kind of referred to some of the challenges of the street network. So right now, if we look at the existing network that surrounds the building, we have Cordova Street and Howe Street. And on Howe Street, that's the entrance to the cruise ship terminal. So if you've been down there on any of the most recent weekends, on the very busy cruise ship days, that just shuts down that area. So having that as the main entrance into this area just doesn't work. Also, the Cordova Connector, although it's really important for providing the transit circulation between Granville Street and looping back, it would only be a right-in, right-out connection because from the east, it's only fed from Water Street, right? So the Granville extension is really important to be able to have that sort of full movement connection for all the buses that would want to come in here and connect to the Hub Street. The recent downtown transit plan review, in that survey, everyone said it's really hard to connect into waterfront stations. So that was a big theme that came across in that consultation. And then Canada Place would provide the extension of the Greenway network and actually eventually connect down to Waterfront Road with the future port development there.
So just to touch a little bit more on the Granville Street extension, what we learned in the study was that one thing that we really wanted to fix was the elevated structure of Granville 200 and how it's disconnected from the rest of the city, the public realm. The bridge connection that is going across Granville Street, along Granville Street, is something that it really impacts on Sinclair Center, and we'd love to see that removed. So we actually did quite a structural study to look at removing the upper level of the parking and the plaza of Granville 200 and allowing the road through. And what we learned was because that facility was originally built to support fire trucks, it's actually been built to road capacities. So that was a very interesting understanding with that the road could go through with some upgrade to the existing structure. And by removing that upper level of the parking structure, the road would come through more naturally. As we move through, I've got this going the right way now. There we go. So the next level down, the transit concourse is below, slightly, it's below grade, but it allows for connections for a Canada Line. Instead of right now, you go up and through the waterfront station and you'd have to go back down again. This would allow for a more level connection into the transit concourse, a below grade connection underneath the Hub Road and Canada Place extension. And we also looked at how we would support additional building structures on either side of that transit concourse. And then finally at the lower level, we were looking at expansion of transit rail systems, and we were also working quite closely with CP Rail. They did require some minor alignment of some of their rail tracks in order to achieve this, but it was all within workable means from their perspective.
And those rail tracks are there to stay. They're actually doing expansion on the two container terminals, increasing both of them by 50%, and this was a key yard for them to be able to support that movement.
So I'm just going to do a little section through. So we see here Waterfront Station on the right, And as you come through Waterfront Station, you're dropping down to a new transit concourse level, one that is connecting below grade, but it also allows a connection at the Hub Street level, which is also important for where the buses will come into this facility. Then we move through the potential development area, those other buildings, and then eventually out to the marine terminal, always with an opportunity of taking a choice, either making a connection below grade or coming up at various points to making that connection at grade. And so here are some illustrative concepts about how the massing of this area would unfold. And you can see on the right a sketch of the concourse itself opening up and exposing the north side of Waterfront Station, actually, you know, enhancing it, we believe. And then the lower sketch at the bottom showing how Bramble Street would actually come through and opening up the westerly edge of Waterfront Station and exposing that elevation and the removal of the elevated bridge along Sinclair Center. So some of our challenges to finish are the impact on the freight rail yards, development funding, Bramble Street, achieving the Bramble Street extension, and managing and dealing with dangerous goods. Thank you.
Frank Coates is next.
Thank you, Lisa and Steve. I'm wondering if you can hear me. I'm not seeing a microphone around here. Can you hear me back there? Okay.
No.
Yep.
Yeah.
Just speak up. Well, while we're waiting, it's wonderful to be amongst former colleagues of mine from the city, as well as in the private practice. Graham Lagarde is going to be speaking later. I entitled this, as you can see, I think, Mind the Gap. We have a gap here that in the fabric of the city, and it's a real opportunity. Anyway, framing, thanks to the micro photograph here, frames the argument for us. I'm going to go from that big scale that the two previous speakers were talking about down to the site scale at 555 West Cordova, immediately east of the Waterfront Station and west of the landing, shown here, just on the edge here. And the question you might have is, cover half dozen or so people involved in this downtown waterfront working group, plus other people who are below what we call below deck, who don't want to be identified particularly, but are providing advice. Why are so many former City of Vancouver planners involved in this work group? It's not that we're inherently negative about what the city does, but sometimes things come along that provoke you into taking a position. And 585, I think it was, Helmkin was one of those things that a group of people that I was part of, as well as others in this room were part of, to try to make a point about what the city is doing on what seems to be an ad hoc level. And so we got excited when we saw this plan, which is located right about there, using the aerials from the transportation plan, just to orient you. The yellow line is the hub study that Anita and Steve just talked about, so it's quite a bit of airspace and land around there. Here it is showing in plan view. It doesn't line up with any streets, so it's hard to call it a street end view, but nonetheless, it's an amazingly powerful view, and we think that missed opportunity of using that is really important, not to miss that opportunity. The transportation hub framework plan called for an 11-story building in that location. It does show, if I knew where the pointer was, it does show the Cordova connector coming through there, which is taking half the space. So one of the framing questions I'm going to have is, do we need a full road space through there? And I think the argument can be made probably both ways. Thank you very much for that one. This road here, which I imagine is a 20-meter road allowance, which would be the same with, say, House Street and other streets in the area. So we got excited about the opportunity here, but also disappointed with what was coming forward with the application. Excuse me, this is a very sensitive device. Another outtake from the hub study, and it's a wonderful diagram, I think. It shows sloping down in heights from the waterfront, from new buildings over the tracks and in this space, towards the scale of the gas tank. to me, that's a framework principle. And it just respects the height of Gastown, which goes up to maybe 100 feet in some places, but generally speaking, 3, 4, 5, 6 stories. In the case of the landing, about 7 or 8. And it also says slope down towards the waterfront, which when you think the domical shape of the landform of downtown and having a similar domical shape for heights of buildings, where the tallest buildings should be in the middle and the lowest building maybe towards the edges at the water, that would follow that kind of principle. Again, not a bad one. Anita showed this plan before, or this sketch. But since this drawing was done for the hub study, I'm going to stand over here because it's hard craning my neck. Since that time, approximately, the federal government has come in and said they have certain space needs for themselves. It could be up to 1 million square feet. It could be quite a bit less than that. But the interesting thing about that number is almost exactly equal to the 1 million square feet or so that is planned for over the tracks. So there'd be a framing question about what happens if this goes forward, will there be any demand left to build this road extension and get out over the waterfront? On the positive side, if it does happen, as Anita mentioned, the overpasses and other poor connections, and hopefully the street extension like this will eventually happen. And fundamental to our thinking in our waterfront group is whether this goes forward sooner or later. If it goes forward, it has big implications, positive implications. If it never goes forward, it has large negative implications. So here's what was proposed. Luckily, the urban design panel did not give it the green light. I put a couple of red lines on this drawing. We're looking northwards toward the mountains and water. What you see on the left is the CPR station, which had a very strong parapet line at a high 3 stories, classical building. And we have a warehouse building from the late 19th century, the landing, very simple format, slab kind of building, also masonry, at about 7 or 8 stories. So those are good reference points when you think about neighborliness and relationships. Do you want to loom over your neighbor, or do you want to be more in keeping with your neighbor? Would this woman here be comfortable be talking to you like this, or would it be nicer if I'm sort of down here and we're looking at each other and having a good conversation? The yellow line is approximately the height of the 11-story building that I referred to in the hub study. So you can see that more than double the height is being proposed in this application, generated by the view cone from Queen Elizabeth Park. Sort of a technical thing, but it's very, very important. It shapes an awful lot of our downtown. The shaded area here is the upper part of the proposed building, 18,000 square feet. The finer line in there is indicating the floor plan of the ground floor and tapering up. I have 1 minute, and I'm about 12 minutes away from finishing. So we'll see how we go here. So it has this this kind of quality of being a small footprint and big building. And we have one of those already in the works around here. Here's how it shows in the setting. So this is a comparison to what the hub framework plan called for on that site. And this is what the development application called for. And you can make the old assessments about whether there's any coordination between these two. So as much as I think the hub framework plan is a major statement and a good statement about the future evolution and a flexible statement about the evolution of the waterfront, when the first thing out of the box comes looking like this, you start to question the whole plan. The area has different intersecting grids. I'm not going to worry about too many of these things. These are the access points, what we have right now. We have House Street, a potential extension of Granville Street, and then the one here that Steve mentioned would be right in and right out, should it go across at this location. We already have top-heavy buildings being planned in this city. I think of what's now called the Cube out there in West Georgia, which has got the suspenders. That's our first one, the little tiny footprint, the massive building sitting on top, actually quite famous in its day. And we got this one here at Canada House being proposed as well, for a whole set of other variables that affect that site. And the question to me is, how many times are we going to do that? So I'm going to go into our propositions, or our thoughts, mostly my thoughts. I'm not going to blame anybody else. We had the 3 levels. What's happening with the? Oh, we got the pointer on. No, is something walking around here. Mouse.
You've hit something.
Anyway, That blue line represents the 15 stories in the downtown east side plan and parts of Chinatown. So you can see above 11 stories is a little bit of leeway to be sort of a taller building because of its importance, if it's a good enough site to do it. Yeah, I get the message. Okay, I'm sorry, I'm trying to do the best I can. And I think above that 11-story height, it has to be earned. There has to be performance qualities about public realm, about architectural design, about access, about what's the good for the city as a whole. Not good for just the development, but good for the city as a whole. Do we have enough, with the red lines here, do we have enough circulation network, should Granville Street be built, to not need the city building? I'm hearing there's a bus, important bus system, but could that be something smaller, just for pedestrians, bikes, and emergency, perhaps, and therefore you have a wider footprint for the building itself? That's one question. Another question is, Telus Gardens did an unusual thing. It somehow commandeered some of the airspace on both ends of the building for, I think, private enjoyment, I'm not sure. And, yeah. Can, if that's indeed a good precedent, can we do a similar thing with that road extension rather than over CPR Station, because the present design is, but lean the other way over the road and use it for public purposes? You're trying to get a bigger footprint of the building, which may bring down its height. Next slide, please. Can you do that? Should the implementation plan, and I haven't really talked about it, but it was mandated as recommendation B in the 2009 council report, there should be a implementation plan developed for the hub. The question is, that means detailed infrastructure, that means streetscape and public realm, that means the quality of things, maybe even design guidelines. What kind of character, forming characters are buildings have? None of that has been really done. So the question is, in other cities, you don't get to build something until you've done that kind of implementation plan. So in a sense, is this a bookmark time until that implementation set is done, and through a public process? And what can be done to open up Granville Street sooner than later? I see a million square feet on one side being thought about. I see 375,000 square feet recently approved on the other side of Granville Street. We have a proposal here. Can any of the DCLs and CACs do those things? Go forward and pay for that. And can residential use supplement and animate spaces over the track, not be the dominant use? And if it is opened up, can the right of way through that site be reduced or eliminated and used only for bikes, beds, and emergency vehicles? And be a better neighbor, ultimately. Last slide, please.
Really? You're taking time away from
okay. We'll post this, I presume. Last slide, please.
There you go.
Hey,
as a consultant in the planning and urban design world, it's chancy to do this kind of stuff. It affects your career. So a lot of people who are involved in this have stepped way back and don't wish to be identified for very good reason. But it is a risk to your career, and I'm knowing that person as well as I get out there. Thank you.
So, I'm going to go through the same kind of territory, but back out to the bigger picture, the context that the last two presentations have been in. Having been working on and around this waterfront area for, well, I can count at least 20 years of various things that have happened. Our site. So I'm here on behalf of, I mean, people talk about Craig Kirk putting the white caps because that's how the rail lines thing came about. The management vehicle that this is being done under is called Carrera Management, and you'll see. So, 18 acres downtown waterfront land with a long-term ground floor tenant, plus the landing, plus 320 Granville Street. The center of Vancouver, right here at its edge. So if you do the general math, you get FSR gross would be 3.5 million square feet, mostly gathered at the Western Hub. Da-da-da-da, off we go. How much, how high, whatever. Later is the time for numbers. This moment today is about the poetry of opportunities and constraints, and most importantly, aspirations. So I want to frame the aspirational part with a quick spin through the history of the future of our lands. Now, the top in each of these things in purple is the planning question superimposed upon a view of the existing Vancouver. So 1968, Marathon Development, 50 years ago, a vision of, guess what, approximately 3.5 million square feet on a waterfront freeway. And the only part built was Granville Square, becoming today's opportunity and constraint, and actually clarifying some of the conditions required in order to build over the tracks. Ironically, for the Granville Square haters, functional needs are pointing towards extending Canada Place, but not as a freeway. 1979, Central Waterfront Official Development Plan. Now the C-Bus, which you can kind of find in there, and I won't try for pointers, was built in the mid-70s. Waterfront Station, which is pretty run down, was renovated. And in the early 1980s, the old Pier BC became Canada Place, towards the bottom of this slide. So this was the period when Vancouver's population was declining, and planning was couched as fit rather than growth. Very different context to today. The linear development was shown all the way to Main Street with little regard to the economics of building on the mush at the edge of the ocean. Skipping ahead to the 1990s, Central Waterfront Policy Statement, the port lands north of Waterfront Road being under the jurisdiction, basically federal jurisdiction. It was a collaborative process rather than a city process. But this was in that the port was seeking a developer for an expanded convention center near east of Canada Place. And this led to the urban plan for the port's central waterfront lands north of the rail yards. So the port lands, which extends well out into the water, was shown with approximately 3 million square feet north of rail yards. The urban form tapering down from the downtown core in the west down to the east. Now, the rail yards were tacitly assumed to be going away. They're kind of inconvenient, but the SkyTrain had been built and West Coast Express was on the way. One outcome around this process was that creating a real available beach became Crab Park. And interestingly, the C-Bus here is shown built over. Now, this is less than 20 years old. And note, the port's retaining a site right in front of Granville Square. Port site, approximately 94 to 99. The convention center expansion, which is illustrated here, was to be built over the water east of Canada Place with a casino and tall hotel at the Viaduct Junction. Granville Street was not extended in this scenario. That the Five Corners intersection at Cordova was already known to be a problem. The C-Bus would have been relocated northeastwards with moving sidewalks. But anyway, various layers of obstacle and opposition, notably anti-casino sentiment and the cost of development over deep water, killed the project. The key legacy was a viaduct right away registered across the rail yards. Now in this period, Marathon, being CP Rail's real estate arm, separated Waterfront Station with its eastern parking lot from the remainder of the rail yards. By the early 2000s, the convention center had moved west of Canada Place to where it is now. And then in 2005, as part of the Whitecaps Waterfront Stadium, Greg Kerfoot bought the CP Rail yards from Marathon. So CP Rail as a tenant can continue rail operation, but the yards can be reconfigured for redevelopment, retaining most of the rail capacity. Now in terms of the stadium stuff itself, our primary focus was on site number two. So you're seeing three sequential operations. The one was the one that all the high level review stuff was about, on the principle of showing the city what would happen if we did it on our land only, as opposed to partnership with the port. In the end, competing claim between the port and TransLink on the water channel between Canada Place and the C-Bus shifted to number three as being the site for the rezoning application that died the day the city went on strike in the fall of 2007. This is not about the stadium, but about aspiration for urban life at the water's edge. Now, We call this the People Tower because who can say no to the people? The stadium was not about 30,000 people coming to 30 soccer and football games, but being an exciting hotspot that resonates in the daily pulse of the city. Simply put, it was a park amphitheater with a ring of food and beverage outlets around a 24/7 seawall with office, hotel, and assembly spaces with an unbeatable vibe. Starting from the assertion that soccer is a village, which is how the Whitecaps operate as an inclusive community, think of it like Seattle's Pike Place Market wrapping around David Lamb Park, with all kinds of seating, sunbathing, and activity stages, surrounded by the seawall and all with a magnificent view of the water and the mountains. So the People Tower itself, which is on the rail yards, was a complement, a vertical mix of interconnected functions, gathering together the density of the rail yards in a singular form of critical mass, unlike anything yet seen in Vancouver. Getting into the hub planning framework process of this time period, we absorbed the ambitious vision of a massively expanded transit hub, as you've seen presented, and the city's aspiration to bring Granville Street through to the water, it's on our neighbor's land, and hoped someone would find the value to pay for all of this. Very aware of how our land and best column locations were being claimed for the transit hub, our working assumption was that building height would be allowed to compensate for this. Now, we did much work on the infrastructure for the stadium, and this sensitized us to the devils in the details of phasing and interconnectivity. The work set the stage for our current version of a range of public environments up and down, side to side, and connected in layers. But first, the Central Waterfront Hub framework plan. This is not the exact drawing we would have drawn. We're very wary of being boxed into third-party agreements. But there is a fundamental, simple, and sound urban logic at work here, a framework we're now starting to flesh out. So that brings us to today. What is to be the road? And what is pedestrian passage? And what is gathering place? What is to be covered? What seeks to attract sunshine? And what seeks to be a winter garden? There are many levels of debate to be had about moving the vision forward, and a few million square feet of successful development need to be encouraged here to provide the unique excitement of the centers of the city being at the edge, of making this place a fundamental workhorse at the heart of the region and a place of delight. Well-paying commerce is essential for this sustainable vitality, and this will also be one of the most inclusively accessible environments in Metro Vancouver. So our planning is starting with the fundamentals of infrastructure, and we're connecting the dots. We've seen the three key control points. And assembling a ring of tall building forms, imagine them expanded like a series of Rubik's cubes linked below grade, at grade, and possibly one or more levels above grade. And the early key question is what is to be placed at the point of compression, that is 555 West Cordova, that will make the best possible synergy with our bigger vision of the waterfront. So that is the context that we're now coming through to this consideration of the Central Waterfront. And time for a conversation.
Okay. Now it's your turn, but I do want to acknowledge something that I forgot to say at the beginning, that today's conversation is co-sponsored by the Vancouver City Planning Commission, and we are very grateful to the Commission and the Commissioners for their support for this event. They will also have much of this information on their website. Now it's your turn. You're the participants. You can ask questions, make observations of our presenters, and what other participants say. We are recording this, and the mics are at the back, so please use your outside voice as you talk, or at least not a whisper, today. Who would like to go first? Just raise your hand, and I will call on you in the back to start. I'm going to assign numbers 2, 3, let's go.
Hi, thank you so much for giving us your time today to come and talk about this. I really enjoyed the perspective of planning and urban design and how that's kind of integrated into the project from various different perspectives. I'm just wondering about specifically climate change adaptation strategies and how that's come into play with the conversations around being at the waterfront level, thinking about you know, making strategies around sea level rise and so on and so forth.
I can probably comment on that a little bit because we're looking at strategies throughout the city of how to address that. And from a transportation perspective, it's generally like looking at seawall heights and the edge of water heights and that. And so in this location, because everything, all the development is actually up at a quite a bit higher level, it's primarily the rail tracks that would be down at the lower level in that kind of risk area for seawater, right? So that would be a question, I guess, that like to connect with CP Rail and the others of how they're planning for that, because that's kind of the closest ground plane. All our other stuff is quite a bit higher.
Number two, and then you'll be number four in the back.
Yeah, generally like what I see with the hub proposal, but an observation is Vancouver seems to be determined to be the last place on earth that has a pedestrian zone, very free of cars. And if you can't make a successful pedestrian zone in the biggest transit hub in Western Canada, I think we're missing a huge opportunity here. This seems to be very road focused. And I see mostly just a loss of pedestrian space without half of Granville Street being taken away, more than half perhaps, by opening up Granville. I'm not opposed to that as long as it's replaced with good, high quality pedestrian space, and I don't see enough of it here.
It's a good comment, and you know, certainly the devil is in the detailed design. So we have those same goals and ambitions to, particularly at street end views, to provide those open spaces, but also at that ground plane. And we don't really know what the hub street, you know, that would look like. Yes, while it might be providing a transportation purpose in terms of buses and that, but it could also be a very much a pedestrian environment as well. Yeah, it certainly could be explored as the framework moves forward.
But I just want to add on that, when we look at the hub framework coming to Sound Logic, it's saying certain things need to be connected, and the next question is exactly that. Connected for what means? Some of it is servicing of vehicles, transit vehicles, and so on. But a lot of it is if you're putting all the development and so on there and have the vision that still is part of the back of our mind from some of the stadium things that could have happened at that intensity, that's a pedestrian, that's a people place. So that's how we're looking at it.
Yeah, I guess the concourse piece was something that we kind of envision as being a big pedestrian mixing area, and how that actually works, if it could actually be something that has pedestrian space around the outside that looks into it, the seawall corridors around the outside edges, and then kind of that lookout plaza area by this sea bus terminal, like that would be the point where you're right looking over the water and being able to have the pedestrian space in that area too.
Number five, who's number three, please? Yes.
Yeah. Number four.
Sorry, number three?
Me.
Over there. Yes, thank you.
Can I ask two questions? One is there any practical legal mechanism for the 555 Cordova site that the city can totally disallow any development there so that it remains an open plaza?
There is, under the current zoning, they have the ability to develop that piece of land.
They meaning Cadillac Fairview?
Cadillac Fairview, yes. So now, it's subject to all kinds of performance, as Frank mentioned. It's subject to, you know, its urban design performance, its architecture, its public realm, all that. I mean, even in the hub plan, we had envisioned, you know, we had envisioned a smaller building, it is a framework. So they've been testing with us something other than that, and as of yet, they have not been successful. So
right. Okay. Okay, so possibly, could possibly remain open. The architect from Curra. On your sketch, there was the chartreuse green in the hub area, air rights or whatever over the tracks. Then there were two fingers leading down towards Craft Park in a magenta color. Is that open for development moving further east, or what is that magenta?
I'm losing track of precisely which slide. But
it was one of your last slides. So your slides of the chartreuse around the hub area and magenta.
Yeah, so that's right. So the magenta in that slide, that is the entirety of the rail yards that our client owns. Because he bought it as one job.
So can that area be built over by some city reps here? That's part of our waterfront.
In theory it can.
Uh-huh.
And it's just a question of where the process goes. Some of those previous studies and plans had talked about, well, if the rail yard goes, you can maybe do da-da-da-da-da, but if the rail yard stays, you've got some height there. It seems very unlikely in terms of general probability that one would want to take on the expense of doing that. And so the focus has been at the western end around the hub.
But you're from the city planning. What's the conversation from the city on this, on that more? East of the hub, what's happening?
East of the hub. Well, there's a couple things you have to think about. It does depend if the rail lines stay or not. So if the rail lines stay, now you're talking about an elevated structure that has to be of a certain clearance height. And you have to think about that relationship with the backside of Gastown. So that causes some anxiety from an urban design perspective. That I would say that we would be somewhat uncomfortable because now you've lost the backside of Gastown.
The whole historic face of Gastown.
So do we see some future development there? Perhaps if the rail lines were gone, but in the interim, from my perspective, an elevated structure that blocks the north side of Gastown, I don't think there's something.
And the only thing that is on the table is that the rail yards are there to stay.
Yeah, that's right.
So this is not an either or debate amongst any of us.
And I guess just to add to that, like during the hub study, we looked at whether, like initially there was the stadium proposal that was right behind the landing there.
Yeah.
And so for a stadium being in that location and 15,000, 18,000 seat stadium to access out through the landing and the lane was very challenging. And a lot of it is that grade level. So if you think of, as you go to Gastown, Water Street actually falls down more towards the track level versus where you're up at Cordova and the station building, it's all at a higher level, right? So you're already starting at a lower level, then having to create building development and then putting it over rail tracks. So it's complicated enough as it is on the eastern end where everything kind of starts spreading out with the rail tracks, but you bring that down to kind of the tail end of the tracks, and it's just quite challenging to go over there.
Right. It just strikes me as we look at the hub, looking east of that hub area over the tracks, I haven't heard it in the conversation.
Okay. There was one component of a connection over the tracks to get to Craft Park, where we have another street right away there at Canby, I think it is Carroll. Yeah.
Number four, the gentleman in the back.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I just want to say really appreciate hearing the different perspectives from the city staff, but also having Frank and Graham provide some of that historical context for the waterfront and some of the urban design considerations from two experienced private sector perspectives is a nice combination, so I really appreciated that. The question I have is, with so many different property owners, some of them private, some of them different levels of government or rail, I'm wondering how this project is being financed and if any of them are involved in the financing of this. And also in regards to 555 Cordova, if it appears there's going to be a natural propensity for any developments there to go above the existing height guidelines because of the value capture potential to finance some of these things too.
So the issue of finance was something that we certainly struggled with back in 2009 when this went forward, because given all the various property owners, and like I said, the city doesn't own any of this property, we do have some rights for roads, we always identified that it required multi-level government support. The port being, an extension of the feds, TransLink being an extension of the province. In order for this framework, this vision to happen and to build such a facility, it it can't be beholden entirely on the backs of the property owners, Cadillac Fairview or Carrera Kerfoot. It's a multi-partnership to deliver this, and we understood that at the time, and that still remains to this day.
What sense of the commitment are you getting so far from those other levels of government? Have they been at the table at all in the process here yet at this stage?
Certainly TransLink was involved with us in terms of developing the plan. It really requires more political will, per se, than at a staff level to champion the development, the vision, and we all know how challenging that can be. From look at our province right now with the transit referendum, right? We haven't got that leadership from the province to deliver that. So this is another major opportunity, and we have to elevate it. I mean, I'm thrilled about the discussion that's going on. That it's been, it's been generated around the recent development proposal, but it's making people more aware of what this opportunity is, because it has gone kind of silent since 2009 when we're out in the public talking about it, and it needs to get elevated again.
That's why we're having this conversation. Number five, what, please.
He had a second part. Five? He had a second part to his question about the height of 555 Abbott Street, excuse me, West Cordova, going above. I live at 555 Abbott, that's why I said that. Going above the guideline height, which I presume you mean the hub plan of 11 stories, there's probably in all likelihood a chance that it'll go higher than that. The question is how high, and what materials, what color, what relationship on the site, what are the benefits for public realm and access. So it's conditional on a lot of things, including, as we said, the performance of it as a urban design framework.
And one of the key things as we're doing our development plan in the process of preparing a plan to submit to the city is to understand, as we skip forward, and as you see from the history, certain things stay the same, certain things change. As we skip forward about eight, nine years to what it will take for our development site to be feasible, vis-a-vis our neighbor on Cadillac and the exact location of the viaducts, which none of us pointed out. There is a right of way, and almost none of us showed stuff that was on the legal right of way. So we have to go back to that kind of thing, look at the existing viaduct right of way, and see why there would be any reason to move it forward. And it then impacts everybody in this circle that we've been talking about.
One comment just on what would actually spur this to happen. When we were doing the hub plan, it was right around the time when the convention center was actually being constructed. And if you look to the west, all that road network was actually developed as part of that plan, and then the other developments came in with that. And similar with Canada Place, you get a lot of those big viaduct structures get developed with the convention center or some big push on that. And we kind of flagged that during the hub study, that it may need that kind of push of a further expansion of the convention center or something like that, because it's really expensive infrastructure just to be able to access and service all that area.
Okay, one moment. It's about 1:30. We normally stop at 1:30. We did say that we are extending this conversation because of the interest in it, and thank you for all for coming to it. You're showing the interest in this issue. We are extending this to 2:00. Number five, we have picked. Number six is here. Number seven, and there was a number eight. Somebody who had their hand raised here. Number eight. So number five, please raise back.
Thank you. I was so shocked when I saw the picture of the proposed building and the way it didn't relate to anything at all. The fact that led me to say the marsh is the landowner. And yet I was also concerned that why did I suddenly come across this? I had seen the HUD plan. The whole HUD plan was a great plan. It was moving in the right direction. And then to suddenly find that there, after what I believe would be months or weeks at least of discussion with the city, without any commentary at all about anybody being concerned. I remember an older director of planning would have refused it on site and made a fuss about it because it was so out of gear with the plans that were happening. Now, how did that then get to that place? Why are we now here discussing this without a sort of understanding? Because if you read the application and the words in the application, you'll find very complimentary language about how compatible it is with everything, how it protects the various view lines. And yet something went wrong in the process, and as much as we now sort of lately dealing with and finding these nice common comments from the people here, and yet why is it that it gets to this stage without all these concerns being worked out before it goes into the confusion of public discussion?
That was comment 5A.
Thank you.
It's a question.
I second the emotion.
Well, so we have a, anyone can make a development application, and we have to take it through a process. I'll answer it like that.
Okay, number 6, Ward Price, yes.
So the question then is, what is required for the HUD study and all of the current proposals and the implications of them to be looked at as a single comprehensive process?
What is required? I'm not sure I understand the question. So, I mean, any development, we're going to look, any development proposal within the HUB framework, we're going to reference back to the HUB framework and look to see how it continues to deliver and achieve the objectives that we has set out in the plan.
So let me put it another way. Would it make sense, as council has done in the past, is to set up a separate planning process and community consultation to look at all these projects in the context of HUB to see whether it needs to be renewed and what the other opportunities may be to follow from? Given that there is so many projects at a scale not anticipated when the HUB's project is done.
If I can jump in here, the citizens group at which I'm a part would certainly think so. If this is the first toe in the door, and it's so out of keeping, as Ray just mentioned, with what we thought we had a good framework for, it does beg the question, should the whole HUB area be opened up to a more fulsome process?
That doesn't beg the question. I don't want it to be. What do you need to do to get that?
I don't want it to be. I'd rather the HUB plan be a stronger document that our council and, well, actually the council's not even involved in this, that staff can rely on and use a stronger tool to say no or yes. Or
you guys are awfully hard to lead.
What do you mean to do? You have a process? You need somebody to say, we're going to have a process.
Should council, someone on council and council vote on a planning process for the HUB and all of the projects as a separate process?
I'd say that there's two different ways that one can go. The city can convene a process, and I know that has to go through a whole deliberation budget cycle and so on. But the fact of the matter is that we are now engaged in preparing a development application that we're assuming is working within the HUB framework. So that's the other mechanism that will make something happen. I don't want to damn the other process because the guys with some development rights put it in application, you know, as one can do. They're called to not engage the community, including the adjacent landowners, but we're going into a process to establish what we can and can't do, must and must not do, because the big decision in there Now is the time to move forward with such a plan. We have seen the take-up of all the office buildings and so on. Let's kind of assume that they generally take up with new people coming in. There's a lot of energy that you can either capture into the downtown. And so we're going to see, what does it take to make this place work? So that will become itself a public process. So there's two different roots, and our client has proactively decided we had better get in there and see, first of all, technically and physically what we can do and some of all of that background due diligence you have to do, and then enter in. We've started the process with the city.
Are you meeting with the other developers to find out what you might be able to do?
Absolutely. Those conversations are happening. They'll go whichever route they go business-wise.
Does it make sense then to do it with the city?
No. You know, I mean, yes, in the second step, but you're talking about the first step of the dance, I think is for the parties with the lands to sort out where are the areas of interest and opportunity, working closely, liaising with the city to get to a proposition.
Liaising closely with the city implies that you would have a process and some community participation with it.
Totally. Yeah.
Ask you some of these questions, so why not set that up?
Not for us to set it up.
Talk to council, isn't it?
Yeah, that part of it.
You would need direction and presumably resources.
We're trying to help the city by proactively stepping forward.
They're trying to help us deliver the plan. As a property owner, they're trying to help us deliver the plan.
Would it be helpful to the city to have a funded process in part by contributions from the developer to take a comprehensive look, all projects, city interests, private interests, community interests, to be discussed as a separate process?
I'm not sure where, okay, what I'm trying to understand from your question is, happy to have a public process around, which we would do anyways through a development permit process.
Single project.
Yeah, but it could be looked at in combination depending on the timing of different things. So what I'm not understanding is, are we revisiting the plan by doing that? So then you think the plan, the basic structure, the basic approach of the plan is flawed then?
You don't have an implementation strategy, do you?
No, we don't. As
so
I said in the very beginning.
That component, along with all the parties who you know now have specific projects, plus the additional things that have been raised, why not have a separate process to look at that? Bring it all together. Council then would have something before it, maybe consultation, and then moves forward. The parties all know where they stand.
I guess I'm saying that we did that when we
and implementations provided.
We did do that when we developed the plan. There was community consultation when we developed the plan.
But no implementations.
The only implementation was that we identified that we had a lot of challenges because it involved a number of different parties and government.
So that's it in a nutshell. Yeah. You work out the challenges.
Number 7 with this gentleman, and number 8 is over here, and then number 9 is
I have an observation, then I've got a question. My observation is, as a former member of the Vancouver Heritage Commission, I was shocked and appalled, that the commission went along with and approving that design in the middle of that space, that Martian Landing, which was actually installed. That's number one. My question really is, and I guess it's the elephant in the room here, what's the status of that project? Is it going ahead as designed, or is it not?
Don't have Cadillac Fairview here to respond to that.
I can answer some of that. So, following their non-support from the urban design panel, the applicant team has been rethinking their approach. City staff have not been apprised of what that approach is. That's the status. So, basically, the project is on hold until they choose to engage with us. Again, in response to the panel's comments.
I personally like to see some leadership, and I'm not seeing that, I'm not hearing it. It's what Mr. Price has just been talking about. I think that in an overall context, this hub idea is great, but I suspect there's just too many little parts that are not being put together. And I think that's what Mr. Price is talking about here, and this is what really appalls me about this.
If I could answer your underlying question, we've certainly, as a citizens working group, have tried and reached out to Cadillac Fairview. Luckily, Kirkwood and their consultant have responded to that request to meet with us to share our concerns and we could hear theirs. But basically, they're not here today for a good reason. They don't want to be part of this process. Whether they're somewhere else or not, they just don't wish to engage. And I think that goes forward with a a certain amount of confidence that whatever they come forward will be approved on their part. I think that would be what I would be thinking, that they're pretty confident about the next time around, or sometime around, without engaging you, me, anybody else, the city.
You visit it at worst.
Number eight, ma'am, you've been waiting patiently.
I'd like to echo a few people's comments from today, and I'd also like to thank the presenters for presenting a cohesive view of what's going on. The first comment was dealing with keeping pedestrians happy coming down off the end of Randall Street. I would add into that pedestrian mix tourists coming off the cruise ships and wanting to see Vancouver and Vancouver as Jamestown, and being able to walk there, being able to walk to the sea bus and knowing where it is to get across to the North Shore. I'd also like to remind folks that tourists, as well as the people coming from the North Shore, would like to have an aesthetic view of the waterfront as they come into the harbor. And I haven't heard much talk about that. I'm very pleased to hear the heritage people are upset about the Marshall Landing because it so detracts or points out to the difference between the past and the present. And while I do like to think of the future, that's not the place to put it. I would strongly urge the city to be a little more proactive in saying no to totally outrageous, in my opinion, buildings that are being put into that particular site.
Number nine was Hare, and then number 10, Scott, and then number 11, and okay.
Thank you. What I'd like to do is address infrastructure. We haven't discussed that today. First of all, this photograph says it all. In the need to accommodate a 20-meter right-of-way to the east of what would have been 555 Cordonia, we end up with this overbearing mass overstation. So the process seems to be compromised by the need to accommodate that 20-meter road. And so my observation and request and consideration is, in fact, that the city, if they believe the road is important, in other words, to have some redundancy in access to the waterfront, because of the higher risk of railroads and so on and so forth. If that road is necessary, then it should be purchased at fair market rates under a compulsory purchase order. Then that would leave the city free and clear of any minimizations of the process or pressure of the process. Having purchased by compulsory purchase that right of way, then that building can take with the hub guidelines. So that's the first observation. The second observation, which is really about the railroads. What we imagine here is that these large buildings will be founded on, from the pedestrian point of view, at the podium level. But in fact, as large buildings, they not only have to have their weight taken down, but there has to be a system of seismic resistance, shear walls, and so on. And generally speaking, that's done by the elevator corps. So we can imagine that this has been an incremental process. A tower is proposed that goes down right through the podium to the primordial slot down below. Then we have to move the railway tracks. Next building comes along, same process. We have to move the railway tracks again. So this hub process, the plan, is a very simple solution or concept for a very complex problem. And really, it demands a much more rigorous approach to see how you're going to accommodate the infrastructure and the structures. And I suggest, and I'm hearing this from the audience, that a clear message has to go back to council that that concept requires further public process. Because prior to this date, most people are completely unaware of what's been going on.
Okay. Any comments in place? We're getting very short on time now. Keep your comments and your questions and your observations as short as possible. Yeah. Thank you.
Maybe I'll start with a comment on Graham might have something about the structural piece. But with this hub framework document, it actually did a lot further work into that stuff that you're talking about because of the challenge of the rail tracks. We had a structural study, we had a building consultant, a rail consultant, and looked at how all those things would be placed and how you reconfigure the rail tracks. We worked with CP Rail on some options, although they said, you know, at that point there still needed to be some more work done as it comes forward just to kind of finalize. They didn't want to sign off on anything at that point, but we went through those components of how the core would land down, how you would provide some of the parking elements, how the structures of all the roadways would go in, and we've got a pretty detailed report of all those components in there. So that was done as part of the hub study. And I just wanted to comment on that. People keep on talking about a 20-meter wide street. It's not a 20-meter wide street, it's a 20-meter wide right-of-way. So when you actually start looking at what goes into that, in most of our streets, 20 meters is the pretty narrowest right-of-way that we have, except for in Olympic Village where we went to 18 meters in some areas. And so that has to accommodate all the utilities underneath, it accommodates trees, sidewalks, all that kind of stuff. So when you actually get down to what the street is, that's about 7 meters of actually paved street. There's an 8-meter wide pedestrian connection that connects up to the seawall and provides that connection to Gastown, which was asked about before. It has cycling connections that would get to the seawall as well, because you need all that for those components to happen as well, right? So that street right away is 20 meters, but the actual paved street surface is quite narrow, and 7 meters is the minimum for emergency access for fire trucks to be able to, so that if it gets blocked by a vehicle, they're able to pass. So that's where we kind of get into that component, and it's primarily for the transit circulation.
And I just need to jump in, seeing as it was our development on our land, we certainly went through the whole structural thing with rail yard relocation, structures, heights of buildings as to how they would be there. It is not at all easy. The devils are, because there's multiple devils, are in the details. And that's one of the things that will have to come into play from down below as we look at things like view corridors and access things up above.
Thank you. Number 10, Scott Hine.
Right, thanks, Michael. And thanks to all of you for great informative presentations. I think about one of the legacies of our city, going back to Ray, is a legacy of integrated precinct planning. And so we have a precinct here, and it seems like there is a piecemeal moment here. So my question is, has there been any discussion or appetite about appreciating that a protracted public process may be challenging at this moment, to do an integrated design charrette, perhaps a week-long charrette, as we see people like Larry Beasley facilitate in places like Abu Dhabi, where you do an intensive week with all the stakeholders, including the economic dimension to it, perhaps facilitated by a third party. I look at people at the end of this row here who may or may not be neutral, I'm not sure, but we have many folks within the city who could facilitate such a charrette, and at least bring some integrated clarity given all the dimensions of what is truly a challenging proposition.
That's certainly something we can take away and think about
during that. I think staff have recommended for the next phase of the application to have at least an urban design panel workshop, which is usually a focus thing in the day.
It'll be much more.
But a fulsome thing like this that engages a few more people and all the stakeholders. And maybe be visible by the public, even with some representation by, the Gastown Residents Association, the Downtown BIA, those kind of interest groups would be very, very important, in my point of view. Good idea.
Number 11, yes, please, thank you.
First of all, thank you so much for the insightful presentations. It was a really helpful overview of kind of what's happening and some of the different stakeholders that are already. So reflecting on some of the comments today about the concern and the kind of urgency of this conversation, I'm wondering if you could provide, maybe India and Steve, kind of an overview of the history of what happened since 2009 and why the conversation died down, and maybe what are some mechanisms that are being put in place or should be put in place to make sure that this conversation continues.
Perhaps should have been the opening.
I guess one of the reasons why it died down was that there was no development proposals that came into play except for more recently VIA's tower proposal at 320 Granville. Now, an important component of the overall hub plan and the strategy about, you know, integrating this part of the neighborhood with the downtown, it didn't have a direct effect on the road networks and the delivery of the infrastructure north of Waterfront Station. So that project is underway. It went through a rezoning. So really the one that sort of triggered the conversation is 555 Cordova, and that happening, and it's like, well, oh, the waterfront hub framework plan, how does this fit? What is it, how does this work? Are we gonna achieve our objectives with this concept that departs from the framework concept? So that's still the question for us. So in terms of the conversation, I mean, I think getting people to understand the complexity of the waterfront hub plan is really, really important, and the vision, the do it in the reverse order, the vision of the hub plan and the complexity, because it is extremely complex. As Steve said, we went to an inordinate amount of detail to understand it from a physical, true physical structural aspects to understand, because we didn't want to develop a plan that wasn't real. What we know about this plan is that it's real, it can be built and it's conceptually presented. It's not to say that things can't change and adjust if there's a better idea. We know it's a real concept.
Okay. You were number 12?
Is that the Scott or next?
So I want to echo those who thank the presenters to who have presented, you know, a very complex set of issues. There are a lot of moving parts here. There's lots of different and equally legitimate positions on this issue, perspectives, including the legitimate development rights of landowners who purchased property or acquired property and are making investments and taking risk. That should go without saying. On the other hand, the city, I think, also needs to demonstrate some leadership. And I can tell you from my own personal experience that in the past, under various directors of planning and various political councils, that we have had lots of examples. There's plenty of precedents, as Gordon Price, a recovering politician here, has mentioned. much more integrated and comprehensive planning processes. We've done that on the Central Waterfront Portland's policy statement that I worked on for Larry Beasley and his shop. There are all kinds of projects that folks like you and others have worked on, like the ODPs for Coal Harbor, for Concord Pacific, et cetera, et cetera. So we have the examples. What we don't have, I think, yet, is the political leadership that would give power to the planning department in order to go out and do that properly. So what I would suggest humbly, with all due respect to the process and to those legitimate development rights, is that we put some kind of a moratorium on this particular toe in the door, as Frank's, put the expression put it, until we know what we want to do overall as a comprehensive study. And then we bring all those parties to the table, and including the legitimate public process, and we have an extensive planning process that revisits the hub plan, which I too think is a very admirable project, but is lacking the critical implementation piece. And then we get the kind of political buy-in and support for this, and I totally agree with Anita that it also needs other agencies and senior levels of government to buy in, because this is a huge project with ramifications beyond just the citizens of Vancouver. It's the provincial and federal interest at stake here. And I really do think that this is a premature moment, and it's a dangerous moment. If we allow this project to go forward as is, or some variation thereof that meets the development permit process, which is a very narrowly defined and limited process that the city is imposing upon this particular developer, then I think we will have missed a key opportunity. So my plea, to go back, Anita, to your staff and to your senior managers and council ultimately, is let's just put a stop on this for a moment and do whatever it takes, whether it's a week-long charrette or whether it's a six-month-long planning process or something in between those two, to get this right and make sure that those interests are all at the table and hear each other and we make the right kinds of trade-offs. This is far too charged a site, historically, politically, economically, and in terms of the potential opportunities and risks here, for us to just go ahead and approve it on the basis of one single interest, which is Cadillac Derby. We unfortunately are not in the room. Very good.
Thank I just want to respond that I like the sentiment of the room that we don't have to do it all on our own. Our client has instructed us to get going with a plan, and that's why I wanted to not presume Gordon and others about the public process. And that's the kind of support. Now, that's support at it's the provincial and federal governments that Anita referred to are the key to some of that stuff. But we have to go out, and so we're putting something down.
Okay, we've got time for one last brief comment, and somebody has their hand up initially. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I didn't hear anything about the city center. What's going to happen to it? It's a federal building. It's being sold. And why is the federal government selling property in Vancouver to balance the books? It's going to be demolished. I consider it a heritage building. And the other question I have about a lot of these developments, what happens with earthquakes? Like those top heavy buildings to me would not be safe.
Comment?
I can comment on the Sinclair Center. So recently we took an issues report to council. The federal government owns the Sinclair Center. They came to us and said they would like to explore the possibility of adding some density onto Sinclair Center. We said, well, council, how many years ago, 20, 25 years ago, said the development that you have on the site of Sinclair Center is capped. So we took an issues report identifying that the federal government wanted to explore adding more density on the site. Does council want us to enter into a discussion with the feds given the previous council's motion? And council said, yes, you can explore ideas about adding some density on that site. It's not to say that it will be successful. You know, it could be zero. Their feds put a number up to 1 million. We don't know because we haven't begun that testing exercise yet. So they are exploring. They want to explore how they could add more density on that site.
Okay.
And as for the structural stuff, you know, they have to meet our building code and all the seismic requirements, whatever the shape of the building might be.
Okay, we do need to stop there. It's right on 2 o'clock. A couple of announcements before you. First of all, I want to thank our presenters. This was really thank you, because you are the conversation. Give yourself a when you leave, may I suggest, rather than just going out to West Hastings, walk down the lobby of this building to the tech gallery at the Cordova Street end of the building, and look out that window. And look at the what our waterfront can do. Sorry.
Post our presentations. Are you going to post them?
We will. Yes, and the City Planning Commission will also post them. Please put your names on the City Conversation sign-up list. We have been circulating here. If you're not receiving emails. We want to thank our sponsors, SFU Public Square, the SFU Cities Program, and thank you again.